How do you decide between competing explanations for events? What do you do if you find yourself dealing with the impossible, such as a cloaked bird of prey shooting at you? That's the question we'll look at on this episode of The Sci-Fi Show. In the sixth Star Trek movie, The Undiscovered Country, the crew of the Enterprise find themselves sent to negotiate a treaty with the hated Klingons. While on this diplomatic mission, the crew find themselves entangled in a plot to start a war between the Federation and the Klingon Empire. One of the central plot devices in the film is a Klingon bird of prey that can fire while cloaked. This was thought to be impossible, and this technology appears to be lost with the destruction of the bird of prey, as we never see it floating around as a technology again in the Next Generation series. Something that might have proved useful during the Federation's war with the Dominion. Still, as a MacGuffin to advance the plot, it is a useful piece of technology. The Enterprise and her crew find themselves being framed for the assassination of the Klingon Chancellor Gorkon, after his ship is attacked and disabled, apparently by the Enterprise. Kirk and Bones beam aboard and attempt to save the Chancellor's life but are unable to do so. After their arrest and a show trial, they are sentenced to life on the Klingon penal colony of Rura Pente. They manage to escape and save the day with the help of the crew of the Enterprise, and the plot to start a war is foiled. The Kittimer Accords are signed and the Federation and the Empire come into an alliance. One of the interesting aspects of the movie is the way that the evidence for the attack is examined and dealt with by the two different groups investigating the assassination. Even if we assume the Klingon trial wasn't simply a show trial, it would seem that based on the evidence they have presented to them, an attack by the Enterprise, a captain who had his son murdered by Klingons, and an opportunity to destroy them, is a fairly open and shut case. Nobody is likely to confess to something that's going to be almost a certain death sentence. The crew of the Enterprise, however, have a different body of evidence to work with, the most important piece of evidence being that they don't have any missing torpedoes. They can't have fired on the Klingon battlecruiser. All of their torpedoes are accounted for. The single piece of extra information, assuming it is thought to be true, makes an enormous amount of difference to how the evidence is presented and is going to be evaluated. It takes the tidy story the Klingons are presented with and introduces information that completely changes the most likely explanation. There are three general ways of reasoning about problems. These are deduction, induction, and abduction. Deduction is a method of reasoning from a set of general premises to a specific conclusion. The classic, all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, Socrates is mortal type syllogism. Induction is a method whereby we generalize from a collection of specific instances to a general principle. Inductive inferences are of the sort, the sun rose yesterday and the day before, so it will rise again tomorrow. It's a probabilistic reasoning and it is at the heart of the scientific method. Isn't perfect, as can be seen from inductive conclusions in the past about the whiteness of all swans, but still a generally useful method. Finally, we have a less well-known but frequently employed method called abduction, where you abduce answers rather than kidnap them. Abduction is more commonly known as inference to the best explanation, and it's the method of explanation most naturally and normally employed by people, at least for everyday things. It's another form of probabilistic reasoning, and it does depend crucially on the evidence you have to work with. What counts as the best explanation can vary greatly, with a very small change in the available set of facts. Spock quotes Sherlock Holmes at one point when he says that if you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. This is inference to the best explanation at its finest. Although in all of the Sherlock Holmes novels, Holmes does refer to his method as deduction. How problematic do you think this is as a methodology? It's widely employed by people in everyday life, yet it's not without its pitfalls as a method. The Klingons are also likely to be using this methodology as well, but with less information to work with. Their inference to the best explanation would also lead them to the obvious conclusion that the conspirators want them to draw. However, it is the wrong conclusion. Is there much that can be done to improve upon abduction, apart from trying to get as much information to work with as you can before reaching a conclusion? Even that approach could be problematic. It's always possible to get extraneous pieces of information mixed in with the relevant information, and this could lead a person to faulty conclusions. There was an interesting story told by J. Warner Wallace, a cold case homicide detective, in his book, Cold Case Christianity. He tells the story of a murder scene that included a stray cigarette butt in the area cordoned off for collection. The cigarette butt was found at the very edge of the area marked off. Had the tape been placed a foot closer, then it would have been outside the crime scene. The cigarette butt was not relevant to the investigation, but the defense team sought to make a convoluted alternative explanation based on what was little more than a random piece of garbage at the crime scene. How do you rule out extraneous information like that? It is a piece of information that is at your disposal, but its inclusion only serves to confuse rather than clarify in the search for an explanation. Inference to the best explanation has two inherent problems that will need to be guarded against when it's used as a methodology. They're not fatal as long as you're aware of them. The first is that it's an inherently probabilistic methodology, and any conclusion will be at least somewhat contingent, subject to new information and evidence coming to light. This isn't really too serious a problem unless the person employing the methodology is prone to reaching a conclusion and then refusing to reconsider as more evidence comes to light. The other danger to watch out for is the problem of bias. If you've already decided that a cloaked bird of prey that can shoot is an impossibility, that it isn't even conceivable in theory, then you'll probably be unwilling to consider it as even a remote possibility. If you have decided at the outset of the investigation that it cannot possibly exist, what evidence could dislodge this belief? There are other possibilities, after all, as to where the torpedoes came from. Hidden launches or extra undocumented torpedoes on the Enterprise are also a possibility. Perhaps there might even be more reasonable explanations if they're not added to an assumption that Kirk, however reckless, would never do something as insane as attacking the Klingon ambassador in the first place. Another rule that is useful when employing inference to the best explanation is known as Occam's razor. Occam's razor is named after the medieval scholastic philosopher William of Ockham. The exact spelling of Ockham varies, as most spelling did prior to the standardization that accompanied the development of the printing press. Occam's razor is a principle that can be traced back to the ancient Greeks. The name was given to Occam's razor by Sir William Hamilton in the 17th century because of the frequent use William made of the idea. It's also known as the principle of parsimony. Occam's razor has a number of different formulations. It is commonly summarized today as the simple explanation is usually the best. But Occam used the phrase, plurality must never be posited without necessity. The basic idea is that you should never add new assumptions to a theory unless they are necessary, and that you should in general prefer explanations with the smallest number of assumptions. This is not a hard and fast rule, but a heuristic that can be employed to try to decide between competing explanations. One reason to employ it is that there's probably an infinite, or at least extremely large, set of possible explanations for any event or observation that you're attempting to explain. Most of them will be needlessly complex and generally ridiculous, so a general rule that makes it easy to rule out lots of them quickly is useful. Let's consider the case we find confronting the crew of the Enterprise. Does Occam's razor work for us here? It seems it might be useful in dealing with the competing explanations, at least if you have enough of the relevant details. The crew of the Enterprise has a set of data points that they need to try and make sense of. The Klingon Chancellor's ship has been attacked, the Chancellor murdered, and his Starfleet personnel seen on the Klingon ship during the assassination. They also know that the Enterprise did not fire on the Klingon ship because all of the torpedoes are accounted for. How far-fetched is the correct explanation? A cabal of Starfleet officers in league with a collection of Klingon generals is trying to start a war between the Klingon Empire and the Federation, and that the Klingon-hating James T. Kirk is only a fall guy and not responsible for any of this, and that some Klingons have managed to build an impossible bird of prey that can fire without dropping its cloaking device. It does seem that there are other possible explanations. There is a straightforward one, that Kirk did as claimed by the Klingons. Seems reasonable, and it is a simple explanation. It doesn't posit plurality without necessity. Is it more reasonable? Does Occam's razor suggest we should go with it as an explanation? It isn't correct, but this is only a heuristic device to help us in the search for an explanation, not a mechanism for always arriving at truth. I don't think it does, because it is reasonable, in light of all the information, to start to posit other entities to make sense of what it is that's being observed. Occam's razor does say not to posit plurality without necessity, but it doesn't say to never posit plurality. In reality, given the case before us, the simple explanation will actually need to posit far more pluralities to cover all of the data points and make sense of them. One explanation that isn't suggested in the movie, one that might even be reasonable, is the involvement of the Romulans. They have cloaking technology, and from everything we know from them in the rest of the Star Trek series, it would seem that such meddling would be the sort of thing the Romulan Star Empire would get up to. Would this be positing a plurality that isn't necessary? It seems it might be, but I'm not sure. We know that it is untrue as an explanation because we know how the movie ends. But this is the difficulty that comes with using a heuristic methodology. How can you be sure it isn't necessary to posit a new plurality? Still, even with such difficulties, Occam's razor is a useful rule for sorting competing explanations. Inference to the best explanation and Occam's razor are methodologies that we use every day, and they're very useful, even if they have some limitations. Without them, we'd be stuck having to rely on deduction and induction and deal with huge numbers of competing explanations with no way to winnow out the ridiculous ones. I hope you found this episode of the Sci-Fi Show interesting, and you can find more information on the different ideas contained in this episode on the show notes on scifishow.com. I can be reached with comments via feedback@scifishow.com. You can leave comments in the show notes at scifishow.com, and you can also leave comments on our Facebook page, facebook.com/scifishow. You can also follow the show via The Sci-Fi Show on Twitter. If there's a topic you'd like me to look into, please don't hesitate to ask. And don't forget, it's fire with a PH. Let me know what you think. The Sci-Fi Show is recorded under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-alike 3.0 license, and the music is provided by Furious J and Maniacal M.
The Sci-Fi Show is a proud member of Noodle Mix Network. Find more of our award-winning and award-nominated podcasts to make you think, laugh, and succeed at noodle.mx. Learn how to podcast, theorize over the TV shows Once Upon a Time, Once Upon a Time in Wonderland, Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and Under the Dome. Laugh with our clean comedy, interface Christianity with the world, learn critical thinking from movie reviews, and more at noodle.mx.